You know, Mike, I've seen probably half a dozen writers that have talked about this ridiculous idea of the Keynesian resurgence. You wonder whether Democrat leadership even understands what that is. It's so far off base as far as what's happening with our new austerity measures in this country, isn't it?
Yeah, it really is remarkable, especially when you think of how recent and how serious the economic crisis is, and in the article that I wrote for Truth Out, you take a look at how, you know, just a few years ago, some of these economic assumptions, these about the free market and the health of the free market, had been spun on their head, and people had realized that they could no longer trust the free market. And it seemed for a moment that maybe there would be some kind of new thinking, new economic thinking, and that maybe there would be a Keynesian resurgence. Maybe there would be an idea that the government needs to do more to protect working class people from the excesses of corporations in a capitalist society. And it's just amazing how suddenly and how drastically that conversation was completely shut off by both political parties. And you have both parties seemingly running as fast as they can towards the complete opposite direction, which is austerity measures in the worst possible time.
Yeah. Do you think to me it's improbable that Obama doesn't understand that. I mean, it's improbable that Obama didn't understand that when he was elected, people wanted a new deal. And then within a matter of months, not only do we not have a new deal, we have Obama looking like, looking like a Republican and buying in, certainly within 18 months, buying into this notion of austerity, which is completely contrary to any notion of Keynesian economics, isn't it?
Yeah, I concur with that. And the first hints of that were with his cabinet appointments.
Right.
You know, when he started putting Geithner and Summers, I mean, these are people with longstanding ties to Wall Street, and he did not throw a single bone to progressives at all when he started putting his started naming cabinet figures. And when that happened, you started to realize that this is just the direction he was going to go into. You know, he did do a stimulus. It was, most progressives and liberals tend to think the stimulus was too small and it did not curb unemployment in an inadequate enough fashion. But then right after that, you began to realize that he was certainly more friendly to Wall Street than a lot of his supporters had thought. And I agree that there's no way Barack Obama does not realize the depths of the economic crisis and the, at macroeconomics 101, which is...
He understood the difference between Herbert Hoover and FDR. I mean, that is the difference here. I mean, here you have him looking like Herbert Hoover in his austerity measures, believing that that's going to solve the problem. And, you know, we know the history on that. It ended badly.
Exactly.
With the depression.
The question becomes, why does Barack Obama choose Hoover over FDR? You know, he had a chance. You know, he had a chance with massive majorities in 2009 when he came into office.
Right.
Massive majorities, a mandate for change, all sorts of momentum. He had a chance to do something big like FDR did, and he chose the direction of Hoover. And of course, it makes you wonder then, why does that happen? What is in it for him? And that's when you need to start looking at the nature of the political system and the way it's financed and the people that donated to Barack Obama's campaign. And I don't mean college kids with $25 checks. I mean Goldman Sachs and other corporations. That's when you begin to really see the rot in the political system.
So in other words, your position is, I think, with most people who've been watching the Obama administration, and that is that they're very comfortable alienating the working class voters who, they, as you point out in your article, Democrats and the Death of Keynesian Economics, you point out that they've taken that middle class, that working class, for granted. And they're much more, the Democrats are much, and Obama, let's call it what it is. Obama is much more worried about courting large donations from the big hedge funds and the people who can put up money, especially with the evolution of Citizens United. We're kidding ourselves if we call anything but that, aren't we?
Yeah. That's absolutely true, and I think the reason that they feel that they can get away with that is because their basic belief is that, the working class will be there. You know, they're too scared of Rick Perry or Sarah Palin or whomever, and no matter what, they're going to be there. So they feel no pressure whatsoever to appease the working class, whereas they have to work quite hard to compete for donations with on the corporate level from Goldman Sachs and so on. So they do take the working class vote for granted. They take the union votes for granted. And then they basically feel if they pay lip service come primary time or come election time, that those votes will be there. And that's why there's so little given to the working class when the Democrats are in charge. And I think that, again, it points to, one, a failure on the Democrats to represent.
How does he figure into the Occupy movement that's taking place all over the world right now? It used to be we talked about Occupy Wall Street. Right now it's Occupy the damn globe. How does Barack Obama figure into that? And should he be surprised? I mean, my thought is that they're rejecting him in a lot of ways. But and I'm amazed if he's surprised by that. What's your take on it?
Well, I agree. I think Barack Obama is more a target of the Occupy Wall Street movement than anything else.
Right.
And the Occupy Wall Street movement has been very militant about not wanting to kind of give this movement up to Democratic Party leaders that might want to co-opt it. And that's smart, I think, because, you know, I think there's a lesson learned from 2008 when you elect, you know, 60 senators from the Democratic, that caucus with the Democrats, and elect a massive majority in the House and elect Barack Obama with a pretty large mandate and get nothing in return. And so now people are looking around and saying, what do I do? Do I just vote for these Democrats again and hope for the best? So, yes, I believe with the Occupy Wall Street movement that Barack Obama is more of a target of the movement than he is an ally in any way. And I think the movement has actually been very careful not to allow what they've done to be co-opted by Democratic Party leaders. They are trying to make it a class-based movement. We are the 99%. And they are not allowing Barack Obama or any political leaders to take that momentum from them. And moreover, they look at Barack Obama and the Democratic Party as a major part of the problem. And I think that shows a raising of class consciousness in the United States in a big way.
Mike, what is Obama's next play with this? I mean, if we understand now that not only did he not buy into the idea that everybody was telling him he needed, I mean, you know, you had Krugman writing, you had Stiglitz writing, some of these people are Nobel Prize winners in economics, saying, look, you have to get away from your Herbert Hoover routine here, and you have to move into a Keynesian FDR kind of routine and stimulate this economy. And the only person he listened to was Geithner and Summers, both of them Wall Street thugs. And so now how does he recover from that? Because this Wall Street protest is not going away. People who are out there saying this is just going to disappear when it gets cold are insane.
Yeah,
what does he do? What does he do with this?
I think he's got a few options, and not all of them are great, but you know they're the options that he does have. And you know one of them is obviously just to play the scare tactic card, which is somewhat effective. I mean, I am legitimately frightened of a president, Rick Perry, and I think people that are incredibly alienated by the Democratic Party, many will still vote for the Democratic Party because of that fear card, and the Democrats do play it well. But it is getting a little bit old. You wish that you could vote for them for some genuine reason, which would be economic policies that are good for the working class.
Mm-hmm.
And in that regard, I do think, you know, you see a little bit of it with the most recent jobs bill, where he's trying to portray the Democratic Party as willing to pass this kind of pseudo-Keynesian jobs bill that is too small, and they know it's not really going to pass, but at least it allows them to point to the Republican Party and say, hey, they're the ones. That's the party that's not allowing job creation. We're trying. You know, we're trying. Never mind that we had a massive majorities and still extended the Bush tax cuts and did very little for job creation.
Yeah, we had every opportunity to do what I'm talking about now, but we didn't do it, but we're going to do it now if we're reelected.
Yeah, and some people will buy it, and some people won't, and less will buy it this time around than last time, obviously, and that will be a problem, and the problem will be an enthusiasm gap-type problem, And it is a tricky situation for everyone, the Occupy Wall Street movement, the progressives and the Democrats, because, you know, we don't want a President Rick Perry, but we also don't want to just accept these platitudes.